Okay, in the order in which they're sitting here, we have, of course, Cleopatra Pendleton from Country Club Hills. That's for those of you on the north side, that's called the South Suburbs. A BS from Western Illinois, and you know that she is the proud mother of Adia and Nathaniel and the wife of Nate. How about a round of applause for Miss Pendleton? They haven't spoken yet. The next, Mrs. Pendleton, of course, is Father Pfleger. I have a long introduction, but if you don't know who Father Mike is, you're probably in the wrong meeting. Welcome, Father Mike. Next to Father Mike, we have Kim Foxx. Round of applause for Father Mike. Kim Foxx, who won a very tight race for the nomination for state's attorney of Cook County in March. Glad that she's here.
That's funny.
This table is really... Superintendent, we may have to... Oh, you slipped.
Yeah, I'm over here.
All right, as I was saying, okay, I'm in charge. Anyways, you know she's former chief of staff for County Board President Tony Preckwinkle, and she's a candidate for Cook County State's Attorney in November. And coming back, probably one of the quickest returns we've ever had, Superintendent Eddie T. Johnson, Chicago Police Department. Big round of applause. Superintendent Johnson started as a patrolman in May of 1988, which was long after I no longer taught at the police academy, and both the Key Academy and me are probably grateful for that. So what we're going to do, Kim, since you're the polished professional public speaker and a longtime veteran at these meetings, why don't you give an overview? We know what the topic is, 5 to 7 minutes. Father Pfleger has given a sort of a pass on, he'll have a few more minutes. I'm not taking him and his guy on. So, Kim, go right ahead. 5 to 7 minutes and lay out the problem. We all know what it is. Go ahead.
Thank you, Dr. Green. And to be clear, I'm getting the sign that it's 3 to 4 minutes. So I will.
That's right. You're not elected yet. I got it. Okay.
And so I know when not to overspeak. Good morning. I think, as Dr. Green has said, that the issues are clear and apparent to not only all of us here in this room, to our city, to the region, but really to the nation, that Chicago is gripped in a crisis as it relates to violence and homicides in our city. That every week, every Monday, today, we get the ticker of how many people have been lost over the weekend, the ticker in terms of age and location. Just last night, sadly, there was a 3-year-old who was shot in the shoulder who is in critical condition as we speak. And so the issue is abundantly clear. We have a rise in homicide, we have a rise in gun violence, and we in the city of Chicago in particular are outpacing other cities of similar sizes as it relates to how we are dealing with our gun violence. Quite frankly, as law enforcement, in particular from the prosecution standpoint, the work that we historically have done is in the aftermath. We deal in a reactionary way to these issues from the state's attorney standpoint, once someone has been arrested and then making the charging decision. But the sad reality is that we cannot deal with the issues of violence in our communities in the aftermath. We must aggressively pursue the constellation of factors that lead to violence in our communities. The overwhelming number of the homicides that are occurring in the city of Chicago are the result of illegal guns. And the fact of the matter is that we're taking off more guns off the street in the aftermath than, again, New York and Los Angeles. And the question becomes, what are we doing in terms of prevention? How do we work to aggressively prevent those who are putting guns in the hands of people who would use them recklessly? The sad reality is that in a number of these neighborhoods where the ticker goes and we hear about the violence, is that it is easier for a young person to get a gun than it is for them to get trauma services to deal with the trauma of living in a war zone. We have high schools in the city of Chicago where we have multiple children who have been killed during the course of 1 year. The trauma associated with that leads to behaviors for young people, and the cycle continues to go. And once we only deal with it after the fact, when that gun is recovered from the scene, it is too late. And so there needs to be a proactive, strategic approach to deal with guns before they get into the hands of those who don't need them. That's part of the problem. We have an issue, and we know that most of the people who are using these guns have obtained them illegally. We know about the lax gun laws of neighboring states. It's not enough to know. We have to do. For those who are engaged in straw purchasing, in the city of Chicago last year, there were three arrests, three, for straw purchasing. There's new legislation that's taking effect that it was just passed down in Springfield that will help give us stronger tools to deal with straw purchasing, but we have to be aggressive in dealing with that. Additionally, we have to ensure that violent repeat offenders are held accountable for their crimes. What we know, and as I'm sure the superintendent will tell you, is that we have a profile of who these folks are who are menacing our communities. And when we go back and we look through their records and see the number of arrests, particularly for violent offenses and for many for gun offenses, the question becomes, what have we done to prevent their next arrest? In addition to that, we cannot be in isolation looking at guns without looking again at the issues related to investment in neighborhoods. We know if we did an overlay of zip codes of where the violence takes its highest toll, and make no mistake that the violence in Chicago has no bounds. There was an article in the Tribune last week that talked about a couple who was on near Lakeshore Drive who were going to go play tennis, and they witnessed a shooting on their way. And they had become to the point where the woman said to the husband, I don't want to look like I'm soft. Let's go play. We are conditioning ourselves to deal with the violence. And in those neighborhoods where the violence has its highest toll, we have to look at the resources that are being allocated, again, not just in the aftermath, but in prevention. And whether that's public health, which gun violence, according to the American Medical Association, is a public health issue and a crisis, and we have to deal with it as a public health crisis in addition to a law enforcement issue. We also have to look at the issues as it relates to the economy and jobs and investment. We also have to look at education. We know for a lot of the young people who are caught up in the cycle of violence that we can identify them as young as the age of 10, whether it's by truancy, whether it's whether they have an individualized education plan that has not been dealt with, whether we look at their reading levels, whether we look at the fact that they've been arrested for low-level offenses at the age of 12 and we wait for them to cycle through, that we have to deal with our educational systems, our public health systems, our mental health systems in partnership with the goal of prevention, because enforcement comes after the fact. And so as we look at how we deal with the challenges here in Chicago, again, they are not unique. Homicide rates are rising across the country. But we have a unique opportunity here in Chicago to deal with all the issues at the same time. The piecemeal whack-a-mole approach that we're dealing and thinking that only law enforcement on the back end will solve our problems has failed us thus far. And the urgency of now demands that we do differently and better.
Round of applause. Very well done. Superintendent Johnson, before you go on, by the way, very terse 4 minutes, by the way. You got your BA from Governor State University.
Yes, I did.
Many decades ago, Mr. Alderman Hopkins, you could vouch for it, I started the law enforcement program there. So I take full credit for you, Superintendent. Hold your applause. Superintendent Johnson, go right ahead.
Thank you. And thank you for having me today. So I'll just echo some of the statements that Ms. Foxx made. So listen, from a police perspective, the only way to make Chicago safer right now is for the community and the police department to work together in doing that. We have to establish a culture of accountability for the police department as well as the residents of this city. So you can't just expect the police to be accountable for their actions. We need the citizens of Chicago to be accountable for their actions also. So how do we do that? We have to rebuild the trust that it takes to make the police department effective. And then while we do that, we also have to hold people accountable for their gun crimes. So in order to do that, we have to restore the trust between the citizens and the police department. The question is, how do we do that? So I think we are in these 2 months, although it does seem like 2 years already, But in these 2 months, I am really encouraged and optimistic about the gains we've made in terms of restoring trust. It's not success yet, but there is. I am seeing progress, and a lot of that is because, you know, we're engaging in town hall meetings with different parts of the city. Because I can tell you all this, I've probably been to roughly 30, somewhere around that, 30 town hall meetings in different places around the city. And the one overarching thing that I'm hearing is, and I mean minority communities, I've been everywhere, listening. Because in order to fix some things, you have to listen to what's ailing people and try to resolve those issues. But at every one of these meetings I go to, the one thing that I always hear people say, without question, is that it's not that they don't want the police in their communities. They just want the police in their communities to be professional, respectful, and treat them fairly. That's what they want. So in order to resolve a lot of the gun violence we have in the city, my challenge is with CPD internally to get us to that point. And we are making strides to get there. How do we do that? We reaffirm CPD's commitment to accountability. So right now, we've established a new Bureau of Professional Standards. That bureau will be responsible for training, dealing with the task force accountability, that you know, the mayor's task force made several recommendations. I think it was 76 of them in all. In 4 months, they did a fantastic job in analyzing things within CPD. So I think they gave us 76 recommendations. When that report came out, within 4 days, we had implemented a third of them. So that shows you that we are serious about changing CPD internally. Because unless the public believes that we are serious about this change, they'll never give us the trust that we need. Because when you hear me say the police is only effective as the trust that the community has in it, I really believe that. The majority of your men and women in blue do want to do the right things. They want to treat the communities respectfully and fairly. Sometimes they get a little bit off track, and it's our job to identify inappropriate behavior early on so we can get that police officer back on track. Now, we have a small subsection that I believe is engaged in inappropriate activity, where there's zero tolerance within CPD for that kind of activity. Those individuals have to know that they will be accountable for their actions. If it's not the type of actions that we deem to be appropriate or professional, then they'll be held accountable for it. And that starts with me down to the last probationary police officer. So this bureau, this new bureau that's been created, they are tasked with the training issues, responding to the Department of Justice recommendations that will be forthcoming, as well as the mayor's task force recommendations. Also, in restoring the public's trust, we have to have a robust communication mechanism and share information and get information. One thing that I've heard time and time again in the minority communities, we will feel more comfortable giving information to people that look more like us. So diversity is what they're asking for, diversity in their police department. And I do think that your police department should reflect you. I do. I think that we're moving in that direction. We had a entry exam not too long ago. The one before that, we made a big push to get minority applicants, and we failed on that. And I think that with CPD, if you fail on something or you do something wrong, it's important that you acknowledge it, fix it, move on. So we failed at that. And the reason we failed at it was because we used information mechanisms that maybe I would use to get information. Print media, television, alderman's office, the elected official's office. That's what we use because that's how we grew up getting our information. These young folks now don't use that stuff, but we found that out the hard way. Because that particular entry exam our targeted goal of minority applicants, we failed to reach that goal. So we retooled. We went out back out to the communities, talked to them, and listened to them. So this time around, when we gave the entry exam, we used, what do you call it?
The internet?
Snapchat. See? You all didn't know I knew about that, did you? So we used Snapchat, Instagram, Twitter, things of that nature to get that information out there to the young people. We still use the other mechanisms, but not to the degree that we had before. But just that little turn in our thinking, which is why you have to be willing to listen to people. Just that little turn in the way we approached it. This last entry exam, 71% of the applicants were minority. 71%. So I think that goes a long way to showing that we're serious about some things. Another category we should hit on with CPD is the community and the relationship building. So we're doing some different things now. My second day that I sat in the seat, I instructed the deputy chief of the training academy to create what was called peace circles. And the way I'm just going to just indulge me just for a moment, I want to tell you how I found out about peace circles. After I became superintendent, you know, you're like, okay, what now? Well, I saw two officers in my office area kind of talking and just going through some things. So me being the manager, I said, we don't have time to waste here. There's no crime going on up here. So what are you all doing? So I just kind of peeked at them, and I saw an officer showing my secretary these photos of these groups she had put together. So now, because I'm a police officer, which makes me a nosy person, I said, what is that all about? And she started explaining the idea of peace circles to me. I told the director of the training academy, or the deputy chief, I want to do this not next year, not next month. I want to do it now. So within a week, he had put together this program. And what peace circles is it takes the police recruits from the academy and partners them up with a minority high school. So in this particular instance, it was Marshall High School. So you took minority students and paired them with police officers. Because I think a lot of the issues between CPD and the communities we serve, you have two different cultures coming together that don't know each other. And when you don't know something, your human tendency is to resist it or fear it. Well, these peace circles help break down that fear between the police and these minority children. It gets these police officers who hadn't dealt with African-American kids before, it gets them to see those kids as kids. Conversely, it lets those kids see these police officers as people also that have the same trials and tribulations that they go through on a daily basis. And it just facilitates dialogue and understanding between the two groups. And I can tell you, last week, I visited one of the peace circles, and I spoke to the officers separately, one at a time, and then I spoke to the students one at a time. Now, the officers, police hate two things: change and the way things are. So they can be a difficult group to navigate. So I really didn't know what to expect from this exchange, but I can tell you all this. And this is why I have my secretaries accuse me of being a guy where the glass is three-fourths full all the time. Not half full, but three-fourths, because I look at the positive things all the time, and I'm always optimistic. Well, when I talked to the kids that were participating in this program, so these were juniors and seniors at Marshall High School, black kids, right, that for the most part have had all negative interaction with police, right? So I was really bracing myself when I spoke to these kids, and I talked to each one of them individually. To my amazement, those kids loved this program. So much so that the juniors that were involved in it asked me, could I ensure that we bring the program back to Marshall High School in the fall when they come back to school? So that's a win for us. That's a win. On the police side of it, they were just as equally positive about the program, because some of them told me, you know, I grew up in Park Forest. I never knew. I just thought, you know, when I go into the African-American communities that they were just bad people. And now I have a different perspective because now they recognize that all kids are not bad. Do we have our challenges and our kids that do need some direction? Yeah, we do. But that's not all of them. So those things are going a long way to help rebuild the trust. So let's get down to the nitty-gritty of it. The violence right now in Chicago is completely unacceptable. We know who's driving it. Like Kim Foxx alluded to earlier, we have a what we call a strategic subject list. That list documents people. It's a computer software program that documents who will most likely either be victims of gun violence or the perpetrators of gun violence. It doesn't identify people by race, gender, ethnicity, geographic area, none of that. It just simply looks at the algorithms use things like people that have had contact with police or law enforcement in their background. So let's look at what's been happening. Like she said, Chicago removes more guns than the LAPD and New York PD combined. Think about that for a moment. And that's not because we're that much better than them, because we're not. It's because we have that many more guns out on the streets of Chicago. The CPD from January 1st of this year, this is going to be a really sobering stat that I'm getting ready to give you. But you need to think about it. CPD, since January 1st of this year, has removed one gun, one illegal gun, per hour every day of this year. So when you think about that, it's completely unacceptable. We have to do a better job of holding people accountable. I told you all Memorial Day weekend is a perfect example of these individuals that we identified on this list. It's a small subsection of Chicago. We got, what, 2.6 million people in the city right now? We're talking 1,300 to 1,400 individuals that are driving this violence. So this past Memorial Day weekend, we had 66 people shot, right? 80% of those individuals were on this list that I'm talking about, 80%. 100% of the identified offenders from those shootings were on that list, 100%. That tells you right there that we have identified the people most likely to engage in this activity, but what do we do about it? The police department, your police department, is I believe, doing their best. The trust issue between the police and the communities, we're working on that. Rome wasn't built in a day. That's not going to correct itself overnight. So that's a project that we're working on. But we're getting there. We're making some positive strides. But in the meantime, we still have to deal with all these shootings, right?
Superintendent. Fear in my voice. Could you wrap it up? We got
okay. I'm
Father,
sorry.
Father Pfleger swinging a couple bats in the on deck circle, and
so to put it in a nutshell, this is what we need. We need to hold these individuals accountable. We need our legislative partners to help us and our judicial partners to help us out. So I've been having meetings now with some of our legislative partners to help us get to that end. So the gist of it is we have to do a better job as a city of holding these individuals accountable. And I will turn it over to you.
Father Mike, you're up.
I'm gonna give you my view from 79th Street, where teddy bears and balloons become landmarks, sirens and helicopters become the music of the night, and where oftentimes the presiding emotion is fear. While we sit here on Grand Avenue, we have to understand there is another Chicago. And that Chicago is in a state of emergency. We just looked at this weekend, as superintendent, with the statistics, 13 killed, some 45 shot this weekend. Too many of our communities are living traumatized. It is unacceptable when parks and porches are empty on summer days because parents are afraid to have their children out. We have a White House campaign talking about exercising, get away from the Xbox, get away from the TV, and go outside and play. Well, that's not an option in some neighborhoods and some communities. We say we don't want violence to become a norm, but the reality is, for many neighborhoods, it is a norm. We see in the other Chicago, we don't hear things on the news like you hear in some other areas when somebody's interviewed about a crime and they say, well, that usually does not happen in our neighborhood. I am so sick and tired of hearing that comment. In other words, it should happen in this section, but it certainly shouldn't happen where we are. In the other Chicago, whole communities are suffering from post-traumatic stress. Too many of our children are becoming roadkill on the streets of Chicago. It is not just the physical lives that are being taken, but they're being killed from fear and sense of abandonment and being disposables and hopelessness that is killing dreams and expectations and hopes and future. The roots of this homicide are deep. And the truth is, violence has become a big business in America, both from the street to politics to the prisons. Carl Stokes, the mayor of Cleveland, once said, "We will not address violence in America because we don't want to deal with the defects in America." He was right then, he's right today. If we're going to eradicate this cause of homicide and violence, it is going to demand, I believe, us having the courage to address the depth of the roots of this violence, the roots of underserved and neglected communities that has existed far too long in the city of Chicago, the roots of unequal and disproportionate use of resources, where in one part of the city there's constant building, in another part there's nothing new being built. The roots of quality education still too often depend on your zip code and your race. Education, as Marion Wright Edelman says, usually tells you that someone's not likely to pick up a gun if they have a good education. The roots of double-digit unemployment in some neighborhoods. You look at the neighborhoods where we see most of the violence, we'll see double-digit unemployment. We'll see the most returning from prison with nothing but $20 and a bus card and a bunch of closed doors and then told, don't come back. The roots of options and opportunities. We hear all the time that Chicago has the largest gang numbers than any urban city in America. If that's true, number one, it says we have failed our children in Chicago that they're going to gangs. But secondly, if they are the largest number, what are we offering as options? If Mike Pfleger is a gangster disciple and says, I want to turn my life around tomorrow, where does he go? Do we call 911? Do we call 311? What are the options and the opportunities? We have to deal with the roots of broken relationships between community and law enforcement, as the superintendent mentioned. I love this man here and have total confidence in him. But as I said to him the other night on Friday at our march, he has three full-time jobs. He has to restore the trust with the community. He has to come up with strategy to deal with violence. And he has to also bring accountability inside the police department of a culture that has not been held accountable. His job is impossible if all these other things around it are not done on the prevention side, so that when he comes in for law enforcement, he's got an equal playing field to come into. We got to deal with the roots of guns. As Kim mentioned, when it's easier to get a gun than it is to get trauma or help or a computer or even a book in our community. We have to deal with this proliferation. We have to deal with these political figures that have been bought by the NRA and refuse to do anything in order to make guns not accessible on the streets of Chicago. We've got to do it nationally, because right now we can have whatever laws we want in Chicago and Illinois, and you can go to Indiana and get whatever you want. And there's no accountability to the person who buys 200 guns and sells them on the streets, and nothing's held responsible to him. We've got to deal with guns. We got to deal with churches and synagogues and mosques who in my business have given up their right to be the prophetic voices and the moral conscience, and they are now part of the problems of society because they're just worried about the people in their pews and forget that they sit in a non-for-profit, tax-exempt area in their churches, synagogues, and mosques, and they owe the neighborhood from which they come from, and they got to start serving that neighborhood. We've got to deal. We've got to deal with the realities that we always ignore in America, and race, and segregation. It's real in America. And guess what? Whoever might be upset by this, the Trump America we're living in now is dangerous. It is dangerous. We now have racism. It's got a second breath from this man. Racism and segregation are on a rise in America. And we better have the courage to deal with it, or we're going to continue to say black communities on the West and the South Side that you are disposable and we don't give a damn about you. We owe them the same equal opportunity as every other neighborhood in Chicago. Finally, before he shuts me up, finally, it's also going to demand communities. Communities have to rise up. They have to step up. We have to restore this broken safety net where we don't talk to each other on the block. I said this on Friday night, and I keep saying this every place I go. You can be overwhelmed with the violence in Chicago. But if you just decide I'm going to take care of it in my house and on my block, if everybody just takes care of their block, block by block, we can take back this city. We've got to become the blue lights to look after each other instead of waiting for somebody else to report it and do something about it. But that's going to take with trust. As the superintendent said, that trust has to be built where people can talk. We've got to put parenting back in homes and home structure. Your children are not your friends. Your children are your children. Raise your children and call them to be the trained up children they're supposed to be. We've also got to change the mindset of our young people, not by condemning them and judging them, but by loving them and talking to them and putting our arms around them in our churches, in our streets. We have to change the mindset that social media and street credibility are what determines what you do with your life. Social media is a joke, and street credibility lasts till the next person does something on the street. Guns cannot be the first offense or defense in which we handle our problems. But we can't just blame young people doing this on the street because they've learned this from America. In America, what do we do after 9/11? We prayed, and then the next day we bombed the hell out of Iraq. We teach violence in this country all the time. And until we deal with it in America, we're never going to deal with it on the streets of America. We've got to change the mindset of our young people. And not just have gun control, we've got to have mind control. And we've got to teach that. We've got to teach conflict resolution in the police department and in every school, from preschool to senior year of high school. I don't know why that is not a mandatory curriculum with every public school and Catholic school in the city of Chicago. Children have to be taught conflict resolution. Last point.
Go ahead. Don't look at me.
The violence we have is winnable. It is winnable. We have the resources, we have the ability. What we lack, we have the desire, but we lack the will to do the hard things it's gonna take than just band-aid it or confine it. I am tired of going to meetings with some folks in other parts of the city and say, well, you know, now this violence is coming to my neighborhood. Well, hell yes. Violence has keys. And it's driving everywhere. And don't wait till it gets to your door before you care what happens on the South Side and the West Side of Chicago. These are citizens of Chicago and deserve the same safety that you have. We also lack the resources, which is why I believe, and this is just me, I'm not speaking for Archbishop Supridge, but I believe that we need to call in the state of Illinois a state of emergency. Let me tell you why. Because the city's broke. The state's broke and dysfunctional. And in downstate Illinois, when a hurricane happens, a tornado happens, what do? We call a state of emergency and resources are brought in.
We need to call a state of emergency, not be embarrassed by it, but get the federal resources so Eddie can hire more police, so we can bring in more jobs, so we can redevelop some of our communities that look like they've been hit by a tornado or a hurricane, and bring back to our communities the equal opportunity our children deserve. Thank you.
And some people think oratory is a dead skill, huh? Well done, Father. Ms. Pendleton, I know it's a tough act to follow, but give it a shot.
I was going to say, well, I have nothing to say because you just said it and very aggressively. Well, thank you all this afternoon for having me here. There are a bunch of mothers in here that I identify. Can you please stand? Thank you. I just kind of want to speak from this perspective. The mothers that are here, that are standing, are very active in the communities. And it's unfortunate that we have to experience issues like this and become active before our voices have weight. I believe that everyone who is within a community, who is a mother of someone, and matter of fact, let me stop before I start talking. Where are the dads that are affected by violence as well? Where are the dads? Please stand. Please stand. Please stand. Thank you. I did that for a reason, because oftentimes the mother's voice is always requested or required, and you know, people want to know how we feel about, you know, things since the trauma of losing our children. They always want to know what we're going to do next, if we're going to do anything next, can we do something next, is there next? And the reality is there isn't a next for everyone. You know, next sometimes feels selfish, and you feel guilty along the way. And it really requires an ample amount of time, an ample amount of conversation with yourself on a daily basis, and with your therapist. I have one. I recommend them for everyone. That, you know, kind of gets you where you need to be. And, you know, how I live and structure my life is that God gave me breath, and so every day that I have breath in my body, I am here to be a productive member of society. And however that, you know, progressiveness is, or however it is that I can be productive, I am going to do it and figure it out along the way. Not everyone has that ability, and there is a sympathy that needs to be given to families who unfortunately lose their children. You know, they're not in situations where they foresee it happening. I think, you know, within our community, and I'm saying the black and brown community, because very often there's where the, you know, what we see on TV every day, you know, someone in the black or brown community, be it West or South Side, that has been affected by violence. I think that we need a resource. I lost my thought just then, but anyway, I think we need a resource to go to who will, you know, afford these families who may not have insurances or otherwise to really see about themselves and to get them on a path of being productive. You know, what I've been doing, and since I haven't been very noisy, is, you know, talking with my son, dealing with myself, dealing with Nate, you know, on the fact that, you know, what's next? We put a lot of love into our 15-year-old daughter who we had great vision for. You know, we thought that right now we would be at college and, you know, inspiring Junior through her actions and her activities. You know, that's what you do. You have your oldest child, you kind of tailor them, get them to where they're going to go. You take the ones that's coming up along the way and you say, see what they're doing? You could do that. But we don't have that anymore. And a lot of the families in here that I talk about don't have that anymore. And we have to figure out how to redirect that. You know, what once was is now black. And now we have to figure out what new colors to paint in that space with our son that remains. He just graduated 8th grade, by the way. I'm very proud. Yes. And actually, a lot of the mothers in the room just celebrated graduations. Pam Bosley's son is doing some great things, going off to, yeah, he's going to college. So he's paving the way for my son. This issue of violence isn't one that just, you know, is our issue. Since it happened to me and affected me directly, my first thought was, oh my God, my bubble was popped. Oh my God, I thought I was safe. I took care of my daughter. I told her what she should do, what she shouldn't do. She doesn't have kids, so I don't have any grandkids. Now I feel different, right? Dang, if I only had a grandchild. Why should I be left with that feeling, Anyway, that's the reality. I'm sorry I digress. But, you know, we tell them, we teach them right, we implore that they do the right thing so that they can be productive. And as they're doing those things, you think, oh my God, I've done the right thing. You know, I'm on the right path. And then someone else who has used mind in my business, you know, comes along and they murder our children. So now what does that mean for the rest of our family? We hold them captive. It's Pam. Her story has been surfacing all around. And she talks about how she keeps her son in the backyard. I'm trying not to keep my son in the backyard. We all have to tackle it differently so that it makes sense to us, so that he has a right to figure out his life and tailor his life. So that's how my story is going. Unfortunately, everyone in here, if you talk to any of the mothers or fathers that stand, they can tell you something different. The question is, what is being done to prevent other people from joining our club? Don't think because you have these jobs that you are exempt. It could be you today. It could be you right now. You just haven't gotten your call yet. That's how real this situation is out here. The issue of guns is real. The NRA should not be so powerful that they control what happens on your block. And that's what they're telling you. They're telling you whether or not you can use your backyard, whether or not you can sit on your front porch, whether or not you should drive down the street. You have people that have a perception of Chicago that is so unreal, but it's real, based upon the noise. Our city is beautiful. I love Chicago, but I hate what happened to me here. I am a permanent fixture in the city of Chicago right now. This is my how I feel currently, a permanent fixture in the city of Chicago, because I cannot dig up what's buried on 127th Street and carry it with me wherever I should go. So how do I make my residents here in the city of Chicago better? I come to panel discussions like this. I am friend Dr. Father Pfleger, and I try to talk to people who are in positions of power that I think can do things that can make our way better. And that's what all of us are doing in here. We're sitting here, we want to know how to fix it. We're looking for someone to tell us how to fix it. But guess what? You already knew that before you walked in. There's nothing new you're going to learn here today. And I say that only because I've only been here talking to people on panels for 3 years. And the discussion is the same.
Right.
What's gotten worse is the shootings. The guns were illegal 3 years ago. They're still illegal today. The amount of guns and the usage of it, that should tell us that there is something that is wrong within our school system, as Father Pfleger alluded to. There are, especially on the South side, and especially in our black and brown communities, there are so many things like ethics, you know, things like that that should be taught, issue conflict resolution. I'm so pissed at you that I just want to shoot you and kill you. Do you guys remember fist fights? Has anyone heard of a fist fight lately? Like, seriously, you know, and the sad part is social media perpetuates the embarrassment. So it used to be you and about five people, six people, whoever knew the fight was going to happen. You know, you get your little butt whooped, you feel so embarrassed. Oh, my God, what am I going to do? That never happened to me, though. Okay, don't try me. But, you know, it was just a couple people. Now that happens, someone's taping it instead of breaking it up. Someone's, you know, posting it before you can resolve the issue. You know, no one's telling these young people and young adults, you know, what's right, what's wrong. And so I think that it is a situation out here that is really sad, to be perfectly honest. It's really sad that we all have to figure out how to rebuild our lives. You know, some of us have more children, some of us don't. How to figure out how to rebuild our lives ourselves and then all of the community. So I think everyone in here needs to take a responsibility, a role, an active role, and figure out, you know, if you are up north and it's working right for you up there, what is it that's working up north that couldn't be working down south, out south or out west? Who is it that I could talk to and share something that I am doing with on the south and west side so that we can make these areas better? These young people are not all broken and messed up. These young people are without resources and opportunity. If they had those, they would make different and better decisions. And that is all. Thank you.
We have a number of questions. We have more questions than we could possibly ask. And We're going into OT. Madam President, is that okay?
Yes, of course.
Yes, okay. We'll go to 1:30. Okay, here we go. First question, this is from Rufus Williams, Better Boys Foundation, Family Services. Still Better Boys Foundation, isn't it?
Well, it used to be. That's why it's BBF
Family Services. All right, well, remember, I'm from the old neighborhood, too, so I don't know. Here's a question. This is for you, Superintendent. You have stated that 1,300 known people are primarily responsible for the havoc in our streets. Is this a rolling number? What keeps CPD from dealing with them?
Okay, well,
kind of a direct question, but
yeah, it fluctuates somewhere between 1,300 and 1,400 individuals, and the reason that CPD can't just deal with them directly is because, as I said before, the algorithms that are used, they still have to commit a crime. It's simply based on what they've done in the past, but we still have to be mindful of people's civil rights. So we can't, if I see one of them right on the street, I can't just go up to them and start questioning them about things, because we still have to be mindful of their civil rights. So what we do, because we know who they are, we'll knock on their doors and offer them resources and services to get them back on the right track if they choose to go that direction. And some of them have accepted our assistance, but that's why we can't just lock them up, because they still have to break the law before we can arrest them.
Okay. Next question comes from, and I don't know, I'm sure this is Marsha Lee. Purpose over pain. Are you here, Marsha?
Yes.
Oh, right over there. This is for you, Kim. Regarding unsolved murders in Illinois, we have cases that have pertinent info, but state's attorney has not moved on or brought to a grand jury. What will you do to have more cases? What will you do to move these cases forward?
Thank you, Marsha. The sad reality is that the homicide closure rate in the city of Chicago is horrifically low, and that there are parents like Marsha who has lost her son, who there's information that's presented, and in the way it works here in Cook County, just for context, is that information is presented by the police departments, whether it's City of Chicago or Harvey, to the state's attorney's office in what they call their felony review unit. And felony review is to look at the evidence that's presented, whether there's a confession, whether there's fingerprints or DNA or any of that nature put together to determine whether or not there's sufficient evidence to make a charge in those cases. And what we've found, even before it gets to the point of presentation to the state's attorney's office, is that there's a conclusion reached that we don't have enough evidence in which to close those cases. And what then happens is we look at the statistics of the number of people who are shot and killed, but we don't see a correlation between the number of people who are then prosecuted for those crimes. And the sad reality is, in a number of jurisdictions or a number of our suburban districts in the city of Chicago, we have a frustration between the community and law enforcement and the state's attorney's office about not charging those cases and making sure that the decision to charge those cases or not charge those cases is based on the sufficiency on the evidence and not necessarily the guarantee of conviction. And that's where we sometimes see a breakdown. These cases are difficult. Most homicides are not caught on videotape. It's not like CSI where fingerprints are there and you can use a black light. There's a lot where we deal with circumstantial evidence, and that's all we've got. And that's the best that we'll be able to get to do. And we need to have our law enforcement and our state's attorney's office look at the sufficiency of that evidence. And even in those cases in which you wish you had more, the question is, do you have enough? And when you have enough, you should move forward on those cases.
Okay. Here's a question, a general question. I think Father Mike will throw it at you. This is from Jane Johnson, City Club member. Jane, where are you? Are you the former high school principal? No. Different Jane. I'm not a youngster anymore. All right. Here's the question, Father. I was a child in Chicago 40 years ago. It was bullying and gangs then, and I can still remember my neighbors calling their children to come to play in front of the house when that evening light came on. Besides the guns, what's happened to our youth in this day and age? Is there any hope left?
Oh, my God.
You can use them if you like.
I'm a minister, so I'm a prisoner of hope. Unless God tells me he quit, I don't quit. But the other part of it is I think we can say, what's happened to our youth? Back up. What's happened to our society? We're a society. I mean, look at this election. I'm ashamed to be an American right now. I'm ashamed to be an American to think that somebody with views that a Trump has, and I'm going to get in trouble with this, I know, is risen to the office of possibly becoming President of the United States. But why has it gotten to that? Because the fact of the matter is that he's exposed a whole lot of America that we want to pretend doesn't exist. And they're real, and they're there, and they're strong. And they have risen up because now they have a mouthpiece. So, while we say what's wrong with the youth, I say what's wrong with the adults. What's wrong with this country? What's wrong with our society? Because the children are purely products of a society we've birthed, and now we have to be held accountable for.
Well, we have several questions along the same line, and this would be a free jump ball. This is from Pam Bosley. Is that the ma'am? Is that okay? Also, purpose over pain. If the this is, I guess, to you, start off with, Superintendent. I think it's pretty much like the previous one. Maybe you could expand. If CPD knows who the shooters are, why are the shooters still on the streets? And do the blue lights work? If so, who watches the cameras? There is no way we should have all these unsolved cases where all of the blue lights cameras within our community.
Okay, thanks for that question, Pam. Yeah, as I said before, the reason why those shooters are still there is for two reasons. We've identified them, but again, CPD can't just go pluck them off the street until they actually do something that we can arrest them for. But even further than that, the system of accountability is broken. You know, these guys are repeat gun offenders, repeat. So a lot of them, like there's a guy that I have in front of me right now. He's been arrested 5 times. He got 8 years, 1 year, 6 years, 4 years, 120 days, all for UUW offenses. That's illegal weapons, where he's used them in attempt robberies or just shot someone. He got all that time in prison, right? But he didn't spend that much in there. So what was the end result? He got murdered not too long ago because we've identified him as being one of those individuals. So we have to have our legislators help us with this situation and strengthen our mandatory sentencing as far as gun crimes go. Because if you're willing to pick up a gun, then you're willing to use it. Otherwise, why pick it up? So that's one of the things we have to work on in terms of the blue light cameras. Chicago's camera system, I think the only people that have a more exhaustive camera system is Israel, a country, and I believe London, Paris. The problem isn't that we don't have enough cameras. Quite naturally, we have thousands of cameras. I think 20-some thousand cameras out there. So clearly, we can't have someone looking at all of those cameras. The issue becomes, and the blue light cameras do work. The problem is, unless somebody takes control of it, it's designed to pan around. So it might catch something right before something happens, and then it pans away from it. So it's just impossible to figure out a way to know that that camera's gonna catch that particular action every time. But we have had some positive results from the cameras, but that's not everything that we need. And believe me, criminals, they take notice of those cameras, so they do certain things away from the cameras, and I think there's a misnomer that a lot of those cameras don't work, but they do. They work, and we do glean some evidence from them.
Okay, we have almost all the other questions are for you, Superintendent. Remember, no one twisted your arm, I don't think. I take that back. Okay.
Maybe a little bit.
Only a couple of people with me on that one, but that's okay. Forget I said anything. Cleopatra, it's not so easy as it looks. And I make it so. Kathy, right in front. Where are you? She left. You leave? Step out for a minute? Okay. Not here. Don't ask the question. Senator Jacqueline Collins. Senator, we were introduced. Okay. By the way, excellent penmanship. excellent. You know, if these were the millennials, you couldn't read it for anything because they're too busy with their thumbs. Sorry. Father Mike, if you need me at any time at Saints of Minas, I'm there. Here we go. This is, I guess, to you again, Superintendent. How do we respond to st- to statistics revealed in recent Watchdog article detailing lack of promotions within the CPD for minorities and women?
You know what? Right now, CPD's command staff is the most diverse it's ever been in history. So you have to start somewhere. So we're starting there. But in terms of promotions for minorities moving up, we are right now identifying people that we can move up through the ranks. But some of the problem is that we still have to get more diversity within the department. So until these people matriculate through, we're still going to kind of have a thin bench for a while, but we are looking at that. Because I tell you, Senator, I do believe CPD should reflect the demographics of the city that they serve. I do. I believe that. So we're moving to that end.
Hey. Okay. She's back. Now, Kathy, how do you pronounce your last name?
Delacheca.
Correct. Sinai Health Service. Sinai Health System. What, maybe Kim, you want to jump on this. What efforts are being made to help officers or first responders to deal with the vicarious trauma they may be experiencing as a result of the violence that they see? Kind of a different way of looking at it, but the people who are the first responders to all this, are we doing anything to help them out when they see all this taking place?
I mean, I can't speak to what's happening in CPD, but I think when we talk about trauma, we are talking about it across the board. So the trauma of the young people and the people who live in these neighborhoods, the trauma of police officers who day in, day out are going into those neighborhoods, of prosecutors who are dealing with the cases of, you know, meeting parents who've lost their children and seeing your job is dwelling in trauma. And I think one of the things, I've worked in the state's attorney's office for 12 years, and one of the things that I think was missing was that component of how do you not become desensitized to the work that you're doing. These are systems, we keep talking about systems. This is a human endeavor. We talk about statistics, these are people's children, these are people's fathers. And in order for you to do the work, they're public servant jobs. You know, people are doing this work because they believe in the mission of the work, and there is no outlet for the work that you do. And it is a thankless job across the board, whether you are a police officer or a prosecutor or a defense attorney. Someone is unhappy with the work that you're doing, and you're dealing with just tragedy day in, day out. I absolutely believe that when we talk about trauma, it's not just in the community. We have to address it with our first responders, with our folks within the system, so that the desensitization that happens doesn't lead to policies that are in the distance, that we can distance ourselves from the work that we do because we are not ourselves a part of it. But there has not been very much work. I mean, we have EAP, employee assistance programs, but getting people to feel comfortable and encouraged and open about the need for therapeutic services or open about what happens is a difficult job. People tend to want to put on the tough guy face. I appreciate Mrs. Pendleton talking about therapy in a space where we know people need therapy, and many of us in here have the benefit of getting it. But wouldn't it be something special if the people who are on the front lines had the benefit of that therapy? My hunch is that we would see a lot less of these issues where we talk about accountability within the police department if they had an outlet by which they can get treatment.
That's a great answer, by the way. Okay, editorial comment, that's all. Well, we have a lot of more questions, but why don't we just have a, Father, 1 minute summary. In the next life, I'm a goner, I know. Sorry, Father. Before we forgot to introduce, we have Laurie Lightfoot, Independent Police Review Board. Laurie, Speaker at the City Club. Where are you, Laurie? Raise your hand. She was here. She is here. Okay. Ms. Pendleton, why don't you just give 1 minute summary about, if you had your wish, what could be done?
If I had my wish, that was part of my wish, actually, the conversation that Ms. Foxx was just having. I wish that there would be therapy readily available for the community of survivors. I definitely wish that the community itself would be more bonded in terms of understanding that we've all lost somebody, and at the end of the day, we all can't have the same responsibility. But there are each of us that have gifts that are so beautiful that could really lift the community as a whole up. And I think if we each use our voices up under our gift, that it would be a force to be reckoned with. I think my other wish would be that we wouldn't talk about what happens in our community from a numeric standpoint. We talk about it families. Families affected today by violence.
That's right.
We need to put people, we need to wrap people around the numbers, because I think we just get so used to talking about, you know, 60 people were murdered this weekend, but how many families were affected this weekend? Generationally, what is that impact and what does that look like? I think that we need to take more seriously that when a bullet hits one person, the number of people affected are so vast. You can't imagine what my nephew is going through. You can imagine what my mother's going through, my father, and so forth. I think that if I had it my way, the NRA would have a direct accountability. Our state would make it a requirement that if there are going to be guns farmed through Illinois, we'd have to see them coming. And they'd have to be a responsibility on whatever freight that those guns are on, so we make sure that they get out of Illinois the same way they came in.
That's right.
Very well done. Thank you very much. Father?
Every week on one of the network shows, since I see there's a number back there, at the end of the show they say, we want to remember all those military that lost their lives this weekend. And they scroll a list of names. Nobody asks if they're black or white or brown. Nobody asks if they're rich or poor. Nobody asks if they're male, female, gay, straight. They're American citizens, and the whole country should be concerned about it. Well, the same way this country ought to be concerned that every time a person, a child, loses their life in the south or west side of Chicago, it's immaterial whether they're black or white, whether they're poor, whether they're gay, whether they're straight. A child lost their life. And until everybody in Chicago, from the borders of the north to the south and east to the west, care about it that way, we're not going to change this problem. The civil rights movement, Dr. King said, never became effective till they got the broader community, and he said in particular, the white community, to be as outraged as the black community was. And when that happens, we change things.
Round of applause for Superintendent.
I think Father Mike is right on point about that. Until we get everybody to understand, there is a real challenge in Chicago right now, and it's going to take all Chicagoans to be involved in this. You know, I'm getting a lot of flack right now because I engage in conversation with activists, black activists. Well, Superintendent, why would you talk to them? Because they're Chicagoans, right, and they deserve to have their voices heard. That's why I talk to them.
Right.
You know, but the simple fact of it is we have to get more from ourselves. We have to get more from the parents that are raising these kids. And I'll give you a quick statistic. 63% of the murder victims this year are age 15 through 30. 82% of them have criminal histories. 90% of them were shot with handguns or weapons. That tells you right there, this our issue is the guns in the streets of Chicago. So I'm gonna be coming out to all of you all at some point real soon to help me convince our partners to help hold these individuals more accountable for committing gun crimes. Thank you.
Round of applause for Superintendent. Kim, to close.
I think my hope is that we recognize that the issues of violence are complex, and that when we talk about all of us getting engaged, we don't look just for law enforcement to solve these issues. I will leave us with the tragedy last year, because in Chicago, we fixate on big names or the most tragic and horrific of stories. That of Tyshawn Lee, the 9-year-old who was lured off of a swing into an alley and shot in the head. I mention that because at the time my daughter was 9 years old, we lived miles away from where Tyshawn was murdered, and my 9-year-old could not sleep for 2 days. And she could not sleep for 2 days because she believed that something like that could happen to her because it happened to him. And the sad reality is that in that school, Tyshawn's classmate would sit next to an empty chair for the rest of the school year and live with the trauma of having a childhood friend executed. And that for those children living in that neighborhood, there are people who are profiting off of their fear, who are telling them, and they believe rightfully so, that they should be armed because fourth graders are being executed. And there are other fourth graders who are taking up arms. And there are other fourth graders who are not getting trauma. And they're in schools that don't have the resources to deal with it. So I guess what I'm saying to you all is that when we're talking about violence, if we don't talk about the intricacies and the interrelationships of all of it, we will look for laws that are a quick fix, and that 30 years from now we'll wonder, did we do the right thing? We have to be thoughtful, we have to be smart, and we have to care for each and every neighborhood, not just the children, because they grow up to be men and they grow up to be women. And we cannot put an age limit on when we stop caring about the people who live in these neighborhoods, and we have to care about them when they have bass in their voice or squeaks in their hearts. Thank you.
Round of applause.